poi voli anche.
Buonasera a tutti, possiamo iniziare. Buonasera e benvenuti. Io sono Ilaria Menolascina, curatrice di OGR Public Program, il progetto di formazione promosso dalla Fondazione per l'Arte Moderna e Contemporanea CRT. Questa sera abbiamo due ospiti che arrivano dalla Spagna, Karen e Mark, del collettivo dei Canada, che presenteranno una masterclass sul tema del videoclip, di cui ci racconteranno un sacco di cose. E questo evento è reso possibile grazie ad una preziosa collaborazione con il Festival See You Sound, che ci ha portato questa proposta e che noi siamo stati molto contenti di accogliere all'interno di questo programma. Passerei quindi la parola all'amico Alessandro Battaglini, che dirà due parole sul festival e due parole soprattutto su questo progetto. Grazie a tutti.
Buonasera a tutti, grazie innanzitutto di essere venuti. Siamo molto contenti, adesso per vari motivi che vi spiegherò. Io sono Alessandro Battaglini, sono il responsabile di produzione del Festival See You Sound, che è il primo festival in Italia totalmente dedicato al cinema, tematiche musicali. Il nostro festival, l'ultima edizione del nostro festival, la quarta, si è appena conclusa il 4 di febbraio, festival che avviene ogni anno a cavallo tra gennaio e febbraio al Cinema Massimo di Torino, e che quest'anno insomma ha avuto dei buonissimi risultati e che poi è culminato anche con l'organizzazione anche a quattro mani della mostra che adesso potete vedere al Museo del Cinema, Sound Frames, sui rapporti fra cinema e musica, che è stata curata da Stefano Boni e Grazia Paganelli a quattro mani appunto con See You Sound e con il nostro direttore, che è stato uno dei co-curatori. Io ho la fortuna di essere appunto, anche grazie a questa bellissima occasione che Ilaria ci ha dato, di essere curatore di questo piccolo progetto, che è appunto quello dei See You Talks, ovvero una serie di incontri organizzati da See You Sound e che girano attorno a delle tematiche che sono poi delle tematiche proprie del nostro festival, insomma delle caratteristiche del nostro festival, in cui quest'oggi riusciamo a presentare questo format, che era un format che avevo in mente da un po' di anni, che appunto grazie a Ilaria e alla Fondazione per l'Arte Moderna e Contemporanea CRT, insomma, abbiamo avuto finalmente il budget per poter organizzare. L'idea era nata un po' di anni fa, quando andando al Festival di Cannes avevo visto, insomma, avevo conosciuto, per così dire, queste masterclass organizzate dal Cahiers du Cinéma, da questa rivista che ogni anno invitava un grande nome del cinema mondiale a poter presentare la sua idea di cinema, quindi presentandola in tutte le varie forme, sia tecnica che produttiva che estetica, per così dire. Mi sarebbe sempre piaciuto portare lo stesso format qua in Italia, però appunto mettendo al centro della questione il videoclip. See You Sound è l'unico festival in Italia che ha da spazio a una competizione internazionale per video musicali. È un format, è un linguaggio su cui noi crediamo moltissimo, è un linguaggio che almeno io sono nato nel 1982, quindi che per la mia generazione ha segnato tutta la mia esistenza, diciamo, dall'adolescenza fino ad oggi, ed è soprattutto adesso in una nuova esplosione dell'era digitale, un linguaggio che sta anche, tra virgolette, subendo una trasformazione sia nella fruizione che anche nella realizzazione. Succedono delle cose meravigliose all'esterno, fuori dal appunto dal territorio italiano, ma purtroppo invece il livello dei video musicali italiani, diciamo, arranca un po', soprattutto anche non solo a livello tecnico ma anche a livello soprattutto di idee. E allora l'idea appunto era di riuscire a portare dei grandi nomi del videoclip mondiale in Italia per riuscire a, insomma, ad avere un incontro che fosse divulgativo ma soprattutto anche ispirativo. Mi fa molto piacere vedere delle facce molto giovani anche presenti quest'oggi. E quindi allora, insomma, abbiamo ottenuto, grazie a Karen, diciamo, grazie alla collaborazione di Karen, con cui eravamo in contatto per vari video che sono stati di Canada, che hanno partecipato al nostro festival. Ne abbiamo parlato per parecchio tempo, insomma dopo un anno finalmente siamo riusciti a portarli qua. Sui Canada devo dire veramente proprio due parole, perché insomma Canada è una casa di distribuzione, cioè una casa di produzione che esiste dal 2008, hanno prodotto alcuni tra i maggiori video a livello mondiale, cioè per artisti a livello mondiale, insomma, già solo per contare che l'ultimo video di Mark, che è qui presente oggi, è l'ultimo video di George Ezra, quindi stiamo parlando di artisti di fama straordinaria a livello mondiale, sono degli incredibili professionisti ed è una, insomma, anche una struttura lavorativa molto interessante. Quindi a questo punto lascio la parola dopo, lascio la parola a loro e sono molto contento di potervi introdurre Karen Saurie-Marchand e Marco Yeh, ovvero i Canada.
Buonasera. Thank you so much. We feel very honored to be here tonight and to be able to show you some of our work, and hopefully you will get out of here knowing a little bit more of this industry. Do you want to say something?
Yeah, I think first of all mi piacerebbe anche di iniziare questo, almeno ringraziare Alessandro e Ilaria, perché ci fa tanto piacere essere qua. Alla fine noi, se noi diciamo lo stesso, tipo noi lavoriamo su questo, per noi è normale, alla fine, non so, e questo è il nostro lavoro, ma quando hai l'opportunità di parlare con qualcuno, e soprattutto se è gente giovane, per noi è lo massimo, perché è tipo spiegare a qualcuno quello che forse può diventare, si veramente ama i music video, forse gli piace la musica, qualcosa del genere. E penso che in Italia non è molto facile. Quindi noi, in queste due ore più o meno, vorremmo provare di spiegare tutto quello che facciamo. E se volete anche, potete domandare tutto quello che avete in mente. E penso che, I think that I should speak in English. So, So we would like to start with a video. It's just a short reel with some of our the latest projects. So enjoy. Before to start to talk about what is Canada, I would like to know if you know more or less what is a production company. Maybe some people that you are here, you work in a production company, I don't know. Someone here? No? Yes? Our structure is just quite particular because Canada was created by two directors, actually three at the beginning. Yes, thank you. So it's not about, you know, like a executive producer and then directly some producers and of course some directors in the roster in the production company. In this case, it just you have to understand that in case you have two or three directors on the top who decide to create this, so the creative is the base of Canada. After this is when Oscar arrive and then Alba. So, and they are executive producer and or head of production. But you know, the beginning just directors. So we are based in Barcelona also. We have an office now in London, Canada London, but the headquarters is still in Barcelona. And also we have like a partner in France, in Paris, with a production company that is called Iconoclast. I don't know if you know them. But like, yeah, we are like a good friends. So also in US, we work a lot. And Canada Duo, Canada directors, you know, Lope and Nico, that they, you know, these directors who create the Canada production company, they are also represented by Directors Bureau in US. I don't know if for someone maybe it's quite complicated to understand this because maybe some people think that when you have one director in your roster, you have to work with him, with her around the world. But it's not like this. It's like, okay, you can get a project in Spain, so that means that you work with this director in Spain. But maybe that the same director is represented by another production company in another country. This is weird, but that happened very often. So that's why you can say, yeah, why these guys, they have, you know, a production company in Paris and also in US, and why they decide to have a production company in London. Because you really need this. It's like, if I want to work with Mark in UK, I need to have a production company in UK. It's not like, yeah, I work in Canada and I have office in Barcelona. It doesn't work like this, you know? So at least also you can understand more or less the industry. So in our case, also we have Nevada. Nevada is another division of the production company. Just work is like a service division. I don't know if you know what is this. Just when you have maybe a production company from another country.
Usually, French companies. You know, in France, it's very expensive to shoot, and they only shoot eight hours per day. So they come to Barcelona to shoot because it's cheaper. But they need a production company in Barcelona to do that service. And in Canada, we have the Nevada division, which is a part of the production company specialized in producing French or other international productions.
Yes. Thank you, Mark. But it's the same for us. Sometimes also we need to shoot in other countries. So also we need a production company that they work with, you know, in the service. And, okay, this is about Nico El Lope. And here you can see all the directors that we represent in Canada. We have, here is Ms. Miguel Campaña, is our last director in our family. He's not here, but actually we are working now with 14 directors. So you can imagine that sometimes it's quite complicated just to find the right project for a director, you know, in a music video. I'm just talking the music video now. Because each one loves a different kind of music and they have, I know, different styles, different storytellings, and it's not easy. I don't know if it's here, someone knows how it works. Because it's like, okay, it's a plenty of bands, it's a plenty of labels. We have 14 directors, so it's like, okay. And now, how we can get the project from the labels? I don't know if someone is wondering this. Of, I don't know. Okay. Ah, sí. I'm talking very, very fast. No? It's fine? No?
Okay.
They say no.
Okay. Well, the whole point of this presentation, this initial presentation was to, because many, we have found ourselves talking to different people, and some people, they don't know the difference between Canada, the director, the duo directors, and Canada, the production company. And sometimes they say, "Oh, you know, but in Canada you have this this style," and it used to have a style, but now we have many styles because we are 13 or 14 different directors, and each of us we have our own style, and we probably have a common style too, you know, and that's normal because. In Canada, they take care of the works. We take care of the we take very good care of the works we do. So not only me as a director, but you know the producers and the creators, the founders of Canada, they intend to have a common visual style, but at the same time with. Slightly different style inside this Canada style. So we should continue with the music video industry.
Yeah, but it's very important what Martin is saying now, because sometimes people, you know, like a music video producer, sometimes I get these kind of emails like, "Hi, I don't know, you know, the name of the band or manager or something. Like, I really love Canada, and I would love to know how I can work with you." It's like, okay, you love Canada or you love Canada Duo Directors, because everyone loves Canada Directors. Duo Directors, but I mean, of course, it's not easy to work with them because Lope and Nico, and of course, all the directors, but Lope and Nico, you can imagine that they're quite busy. So now we are doing maybe once or two videos per year. The last one, it was Beck. I don't know if someone, yes? So this was, you know, or the biggest music video last year. 2 years ago, it was Tame Impala. Yeah. And like this, you know, every year we have the big music video. So, but I can understand that, you know, the people is very, very confused with this. It's like, okay, we know it's not easy to have the director that they call Canada and the same name for the production company, but slowly we should show the world that we have a lot of directors and they are amazing with different styles. And all the Mark is saying now, it's true. It's like maybe they have something in common. I don't know what it is, but it's something. But each one is very different. And now it's true that it's possible to watch a music video, Canada music video, like, okay, this is from Canada, but this is not Lope and Nico, this is Mark, or this is Roger, this is Femke, I don't know. And this is very beautiful, but it's important, you know, just to explain, because sometimes it's very, very confusing with everyone. Okay.
And now we talk about how the music industry comes, because you were saying some people write you an email asking, "I want to work with Canada. How much is it to make a music video?" And it doesn't work like that, right?
Yeah, I don't know. Someone is playing in a band here or something. I don't know. Is musicians? No. Okay, one. Okay. So I don't know how you want to send an email, a production company, like, okay, I want a music video. It's incredible. A lot of emails that I get every day, like, "Hi, my name is this. I have a band on, I'm an artist. I love all the, you know, all the stuff that you have, you're doing. And how much it costs a music video?" It's like, wrong. It doesn't work like this. I mean, music video is about passion, is about work a lot, but a lot, really. Trust me, it's not about, yeah, I'm working in the office, I don't know, from 9 till 6. No, it's when you're working a music video, you don't have life, in a good way, but you don't have life till you finish your music video. So that means that the director and everyone involved in the music video, they have to love the song, love the band, and really believe in the idea. So when people is, okay, how much it costs a music video? It's like, come on, it's not about money. It's about, show me the song, show me what you're doing now, show me your album, show me your art, you know, the artwork of the album, show me everything. Maybe you are not famous, it's fine. Maybe you don't have a lot of money, it's fine too. I mean, we're here about the creativity. It's not about money. Canada is not about how much, you know. It's this month, with this music video, I'm going to get a lot of money. Of course not. That's why we're working on commercials. So commercial just to earn money, and music video just enjoy. And all the production companies like this. I mean, it's not only Canada, but Canada especially is a production company, maybe in Spain, it's the only production company that really, really believe in the music videos.
Actually, so, let me say this. I told Alessandro yesterday. In Spain, Karen is the only person in the country with her job position. There's no more music video producers in the whole country. So she's the only one. She's unique.
Remember, I don't have life. I mean, just remember this always. But no, but it's because, you know, maybe you can find a lot of production company, you know, in Madrid, in Barcelona, but there are producers that at the same time they're doing a commercials and sometimes some music videos, like, okay, I don't know, 3 per year, 4 per year. The last year in 2017, was more or less between 14 or 16 music videos. So come on, I mean, it's a lot. But this is, you know, because Canada, the production company, really believes in this. So
well, actually, the production company was created in order to make music videos. The directors, they were represented by another Spanish production company, and they founded this Canada to make their personal projects, which were music videos. And thanks to El Guincho, that music video made them famous around the world, and after that they continued making more music videos. So they know the importance of the music video in our industry. So that's the reason Canada invests a lot in music videos, not only money but in infrastructure. As in the case of Karen, that's the reason Canada is the only production company with this job position.
Yeah, it's just, you know, because they believe in this. In Spain, because it's true that in the UK it's totally different. Also in Paris, Iconoclast, actually the production company that I've been talking about before, they have a head of music video and a music video producer. Because okay, you know, this kind of production company, of course, that they believe in this. But it's true in Spain, it's not very common. So that's why it doesn't exist. Lydia, yeah, you are a music video producer, doesn't exist. But in UK, of course, yes. I mean, it's in UK, it's that's why it makes sense, all that we are going to explain now about the music video industry. Because before, I've been explaining about this email, like, I want to work with you. How much it costs this music video? With this kind of emails, please don't send me this, never. I mean, if you want to send me this next week, just say hello. I mean, let me show you my songs. Like, yeah, of course, we're going to listen everything. Not like, okay, how much it costs. But it's not very easy because it's like, okay, let's talk. How much, I know, like, at least it's true that we need a minimum, but it's like, okay, how much do you want to spend, like this? But it's not always like this. I mean, you have to imagine that you can get these kind of emails with the little bands, but all the bands from UK,
US.
Yeah, and in US as well, they are inside of this music and music video industry. Because you really need. You need the manager, you need the label, you need the video commissioner, and you need the video rep. That now we're going to explain everything so you can understand better how we get all these projects. Sometimes it's true that we have a good relation with some bands, maybe with some labels, but the most important thing is that we have a structure, the easy and fast way to get all the tracks, briefs, and everything from the labels. And after that, we decide with who we want to work or not. And so the first thing, we have the label with some bands.
So inside the label, you have the artist?
Yeah, inside the label, you have the artist, of course, the manager of each artist. The manager, it's not very easy because also they have a management. That it's another thing completely different from the label, but sometimes also you can find, I don't know, like it's not the manager, but it's someone that take care of that band in the label. You know, it's just, I don't know in Italy, because in Spain it doesn't work like this, but in UK, it's plenty of the positions inside of the labels, but a lot. It's like, okay, you have, I don't know, like a manager who take care of two bands and another one, you know, like this. I mean, it's always like this. I usually go to London just to do this kind of visit with the labels, and it's like this, like, I can't believe it. You know, it's a lot of people working here. And maybe it's, you know, like alternative and underground labels, like, okay, but it's huge. It's, you know, it's like, okay, this is UK. because they really believe in music. It's like this. I think that Italy and Spain is more or less the same. We don't have this. Maybe you have a Sony Italy. Of course, we have Warner, Universal, Sony, and everything, and also independent labels in Barcelona and in Madrid. But the same person is who take care of everything. But there in UK, not. That's why we always we work with a video commissioner always in our music videos. If a little bit, maybe not, but. You know, mostly we even, have to work with them.
Even small bands have video commissioners.
Yeah, but I'm talking maybe, you know, the Spanish ones.
Oh, okay.
But the other ones, yes.
Maybe you should tell them the difference between the video commissioner and the manager.
Yeah, or at least explain what is the video commissioner. Because maybe if you love music, maybe also is something that you want to do in the future. And maybe you can do it here and you have to move there. But I think I would love to do that. The video commissioner is like, okay, the person that is working with the band is like, okay, now we have to do a music video. And maybe if you are a big band, it's normal that you're going to get a lot of treatments. Treatment just, you know, the idea that the director sent to the label. But if not, you have to ask a lot of the directors just to get these treatments, and then decide which idea you love and which one you want to work. So the video commission is a person that, for one side, has to understand very well the band, the label, the music, the album, the project, and for the other hand, has to know very well about music videos. And about the directors and about the production companies. So actually the video commissioner works with the same time with the band and with the management about the idea. So it's like, okay, we have this track. We want to do like, I don't know, like this music video with the band is doing a performance. And I don't know, we want to shoot maybe like in a summer vibe, whatever. So they write this this brief, and after this, they send to us. But they don't send directly. They don't send directly to me. They send to another position that is called director rep or video rep. It's a freelance person who knows us very well, who knows the labels and the video commissioners very well, and say like, okay, Karen, look, I get this from, I don't know, Island Records, and I think that maybe can suit you well. It's like, so it's that moment when, okay, I have to listen the song, like, okay, it's a good track, money, okay, brief, okay, and of course, it's not. I'm not doing this alone. I'm working with a team. But we decide to which directors we have to send this brief, and we send the brief. What happened later, Mark, when you get this brief?
I guess the brief arrives to Karen, and then Karen and the bosses in Canada. EP and the EP is executive producer and the head of production. They decide. You know, we are 14 directors. So who's this? Who's the best director for this project? So, and then sometimes they decide it's me, and sometimes they just decide it's someone else. And then I get angry because I think it should be me, the one who.
But it's not easy because, as I said before, we work.
We're 13 kids wanting to do music videos all the time. So.
True. But we are working a commercial too, so not everyone is available all the time. So maybe you get, you know, an amazing track, an amazing brief. That does, you have to understand, doesn't happen very often. You know, when everything is perfect, and. It's like, okay, this is for you. Maybe Mark is like, so sorry, I'm doing a commercial. Of course, he wants to do it, but maybe I have another producer taking care of your project and like, sorry, Karen, he's working a commercial. And sometimes happen this. But we're working all the time just to try to find, you know, the best brief and the best song for each director, and this is not very easy. That's why I think that this job is amazing, because it's not just about money. I mean, because as a producer, I have to do the budget of the project. So you have to know very well about all the suppliers and how much it costs everything. And also to understand when you read an idea, I don't know if we have, maybe later we want to show a treatment. So also my job is just read all the treatment, like, okay, let's do it. It's like, okay, so I see that we need maybe 2 days to work with this kind of lens, with this, I don't know, camera, and how many people we need in the crew, and all this kind of stuff. And but also part of my job, of course, is just recognize, you know, the good music, the good labels, also good bands. Maybe they are not very, very famous, but that you can understand that they have something. And also some intuition about your directors, because you have to know them very, very well. And what they are looking for every year, which kind of music they need this year, because also the director changes and the taste changes. I mean, just not, I think to understand Canada is not like about, okay, Canada is just El Guincho, because 10 years later, if you check all our music videos, you can understand that it's amazing, because it's plenty of different things, also animation, and now we want to do electronic music. Now we have trap, hip hop, I don't know, pop, indie rock music, of course, but you know, it's, we have everything. And Mark, you want to explain your work?
Yeah, maybe we can get a bit deeper into the music and into the creative part of the music video production. So we're going to play my latest music video for George Ezra, which is, I think it's a good example of how the international production music video industry works. So let's play it.
Don't matter now.
Thank you. Okay, so let's recap just for 1 minute. As Karen said, we have in the label we have the artist, we have the manager, we have the video commissioner, and the video commissioner for me he's like a or she is like a curator, like an art curator. So he needs to understand what the artist needs. So this was the first single of the new album of George Ezra. So it was like a big deal, and everyone was very nervous about it. It is a pop song. This is a little bit over the average budget music videos. So. You can imagine when with this kind of budgets, you don't have the flexibility or the freedom that you could have in a more indie music video. So it was a big deal. This video commissioner knows that this is a big deal, and he listens to the song, he talks to the artist, to the manager, and he. With the artists, think in how this music video should look like, and they write a brief, and here we have an example of how a brief should how a real brief looks like.
I think this is very useful to know and to see. I mean, you're lucky. Because I think that I never seen a brief before to arrive Canada, so it's weird because depends of the label that you are working for. I think it's more about label and sometimes about the band. You have this kind of brief that it's a good brief in terms that it's very clear and you can understand, like, okay, I have to shoot these days, I have this budget. The delivery date is this day. And also, I mean, now I want to show you better, but a Sony is very particular because always write this, deal up, deal down. So it's clear. It's like, okay, don't do that. And if you want, try to do this because maybe it's a right path. Okay, just try. But it's a lot of artists that they just decide to write, I don't know, maybe five lines in the same email, like, okay, this is a track, my vibes maybe is this, and maybe they send you like a five or six maybe videos, like a reference, like, we are thinking on this. So, you know, everybody is different, but when you see this kind of brief, it's good in terms that it's very clear what they want, but it's not good because that means that you are not going to have freedom. Remember this always. So in this case, it's what is going to happen when you get this.
Yeah. So this brief modified by us for legal reasons. You won't find the name of the artist or the track, but nor the budget. But as you can see. In this briefs, you always find the name of the artist, the track, the shooting dates, which are very important because the artists are always traveling and they have a lot they have a very difficult agenda. So this is the day they can shoot, and that's the day you have to shoot. So the delivery date, the budget, and the treatment due. The treatment is a document. I will show you after this. And the treatment is a document written by the director explaining how I'm going to direct, what's my idea for this music video. So in the brief, you find, okay, for example, George is back, and Don't Matter Now is the first single from his forthcoming second album. And we'd love it to act as an introduction to the themes of the new record. So basically, they say that with this first music video, we are going to set the new image of the artist, which is a big deal and a big responsibility. The new album has a couple of recurring themes. On the one hand, it's a record about this guy's relationship with his girlfriend, and on the other hand, it's about a sense of needing to escape the anxiety induced by the political events of 2016. That's quite deep. So, and then, this is something that they don't usually do it, but in this case, we find also a writing of the artist giving his point of view of the song and maybe what he's looking for what he's expecting from this music video or from this treatment we are going to deliver. He says, I'm aware that everybody has had a go at tweeting just how shit 2016 was, and I know that it was a year that was hard to put a finger on. So, well, basically he says that 2016 was not a good year. There were these anyway, so... And the guy he felt guilty because he ran away, whatever. So Don Materna is telling me myself not to overthink the everyday, to remind myself of what it is I have and not what I like. Not what I lack, sorry. Okay, so to sum it up, the song must have a good vibe and this feeling of don't give a shit about anything. And then this thing that Karen was saying, the dial up and dial down, which helps a lot when writing an idea, because they want humor and sense of the absurd. They want surreal elements. They want something playful and fun, down to earth, which is quite weird that they ask something down to earth and with surreal elements. But anyways, you have to read between lines.
Always with the big labels. This is if maybe in the future you're going to be, I know, if you became a music video producer, you have to understand that when you work with the big labels, it's not easy, because they have also a marketing department that they want to control it. Career, that it's normal. I mean, if you're working with a pop artist, you have to understand, like, okay, I want to be a director, I want to do a music video, but if you want with a pop artist, what do you want? I mean, you have to understand, you have to work with a marketing department. But of course not if you're working maybe with this kind of artist, like more creative, more alternative, that maybe they don't have too much money, but of course they give you freedom. So always the perfect artist, I think, is this one that maybe they have an amazing music, they have more or less a good budget, and also give you like the chances to do whatever you want. But that happened once, you know, per year, so it's not easy. Yeah. But it happens sometimes.
It'd be great to win the lottery too.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is the treatment I wrote for George Ezra's music video. I want to make this clear. This is how we do the treatments. This is the way I particularly do the treatments, because I write them myself and I find the references by myself. But and every production company and every director makes their own treatments in their own personal way, okay? But I think it's very important to write as little as possible, as less as possible, because we are talking about very busy people that are going to read a lot of treatments and they don't want to spend a lot of time reading. So the best, my advice is to find the perfect images and the perfect video to show the artist and the label what you want to do, okay? So I start with the cover. In the cover, I already tried to portray the feeling and the idea of George Ezra, the ice cream. You know, it's going to be something summer in summer, the car, and you know, the feeling of just trying to go away and leave everything behind. And then I always like to introduce the treatment with a hello and saying some things about how I feel about writing this treatment. In this case, George and I we are friends, so we knew each other before I wrote this treatment, because he lived in Barcelona for a while and we used to hang out. And I remember him telling me he was composing this new album, and in this introduction I just talk a little bit about it, and then I explain the idea. Let me read it out loud. Okay. After reading the brief and knowing about the way George felt and the conclusions he arrived to, it touched me. It touched me because 2016 was a bad damn year indeed. Now, after everything that's happened, I genuinely want people to feel happy and released when watching George Don't Matter Now video. I imagine this film as a journey, and since this is a personal song, George should be the center of that journey. I see George getting in a car and driving away. We don't know where, it doesn't matter. It's just a beautiful journey across any country, going through mountains, rivers, and small towns. But this is not only George's journey. I truly believe this song has a message that involves a whole generation, and I'd like to create the feeling of a collective journey. Everything we hear, every time we hear Don't Matter Now during the song, it's not only George singing, but a lot of people saying it. That gave me the idea of having different people saying or illustrating the words Don't Matter Now every time we hear them. So basically, we have three main parts: George's journey, George performing the song, and people, the idea of a whole generation, telling to the audience that it don't matter now in a funny and quirky way. Okay. Okay. So, and now I put a couple of references of tone and vibe that I think would suit very well to this video. One of them is a music video for Battles called Ice Cream, which I remember I liked the edit, because it had the summer vibe and the edit, because it had a very interesting edit with a very interesting pace, and also the Marilyn Monroe video, also because the same reasons basically. And and also because there's this part where Pharrell sings girls, 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 and every time he says girls, we see a different girl in a very like a cool way. And I like that idea for the Don't Matter Now. And every time we hear Don't Matter Now, I wanted to put an image portraying the Don't Matter Now feeling. And then we get into the structure of the video. So the first part would be the car. So George gets in the car with his dog, which this is a funny anecdote, but George doesn't like dogs at all.
And remember, he doesn't have the license.
Oh yeah, he doesn't have the driving license.
What?
Which,
yeah, it was very interesting. This is just amazing how we got this, I don't know, this stream. This video, like, I remember when we received, you know, this email, like, we love the idea, we really want to do, you know, work with you guys, we'd be amazing. Like, yeah, I mean, amazing. I remember I was in London and I've got this email, like, oh, this is amazing. I mean, I'm going to go tomorrow to Sony, you know, in person, just to do this this meeting again with this video commissioner that we already worked before with her. Like, oh, this is amazing. Yeah, just one thing, Karen. So the problem is, he doesn't have a license, perfect. And it's true, maybe he doesn't love dogs, but we love the idea. So it's weird. I mean, with another kind of artist, the artist is going to say, hey, let's talk, let's do maybe a call or something. Like, okay, I love the vibe, but is something wrong here because, you know, I can drive this car. But I like the vibes, I don't know, maybe happen. But he's like, okay, I love the idea, I can do that, but my marketing department is saying, like, this is the best, so why not? I mean, it's like, Canada can do it, let's do it. So everything is fake. That's why this video, maybe you're seeing a video and maybe you can understand how, you know, all the work that is behind of this video. Because also you can understand, we can work with a dog more than, I don't know, 8 hours, 10 hours per day. We work a lot with this dog, and sometimes as we can work with this amazing animal, we use a stuffed
dog.
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know the name, but you can understand. Even I don't know in Italian actually, but
peluche.
It's like Catalan peluche. So it's like, really, I mean, and maybe you haven't realized, but if you watch again the video in the drone shot, I mean, it's not a dog, of course not. I mean, it's like this all the time in this video.
But actually, it wasn't even a dog, it was a teddy bear, it was bear.
And I remember, I think something wrong with the eyes. And I remember, you know, with the scissors, just cutting the hair here. I mean, it was just funny, yeah.
This is not a dog. Now, maybe you can see it's not a dog at all. And we shot this with a camera car, so the car was on a platform with wheels. But there are some shots that the car is not being driven by George, obviously. And maybe you can see the guy with the wig. This is the body double with a wig.
I don't remember. Yeah, exactly, because we should find, you know, a guy more or less like him, but, you know, the color of the hair is not easy at all. It's like, okay, let's use this weekend, let's see. Yeah.
So we had a grip, una grúa, in the camera car, so we could make this effect, you know, as if he was driving and approaching the camera, but it's the camera approaching the guy, not the other way around.
Yeah. I mean, it's easy because yesterday we have been talking to Alessandro about, you know, music videos and everything, and at some point we watch a video, like, okay, maybe this video is not very expensive. It's like, you know, guys, when someone told me, like, about this video, maybe it's not expensive, like, well, I mean, maybe you're watching this, you're saying, like, yeah, you maybe you spend one day doing this, and maybe it's not so difficult. Three days shooting this music video, and it's quite expensive. Because you need a lot of things just to do a good shot with the car. You know, we have plenty of different shots with the car. And if this guy doesn't have the license, so you can imagine everything. And also we have a lot of casting. Also we have an amazing shot with the sunrise and the house. I mean, I don't know. I mean, for us it's different because we're working on these kind of things. I don't know, when the people is watching the music videos, or I don't know, commercial and everything, if they realize a lot, you know, all the work and all the money that is behind of this, I don't know. Just because if you love this, you should understand this. You should understand this because it's about how, I don't know, how understand the production. And in case if you want to become a producer, not a music video producer, also a producer with commercial and everything, you just understand, like, okay, Mark, this idea is too expensive. You can write this. also this is my job. It's like, so sorry, but it's true. I mean, it's amazing, like, okay, I want to be a director. So I don't know, maybe you want to be a director and you want to write like, yeah, this is an amazing idea. Yes, of course, an amazing idea. But do you have, I don't know, $100,000? So it's not a good idea, come on. If you want to be a good director, you have just to understand like, okay, I have this song, I have this artist, I have this money, let's do it. But please think something that it's doable, just this. So, and also this, that means that you are a good director. And Mark, I think it's a good director sometimes.
No, no, I always say, think small and then make it big. But I don't know how to do it. I just...
But at least you listen. At least it's true. But you can listen. But I mean, I think this is also a good advice because about creativity, it's not about money. It's about, you know, when you find a good concept, please. It's about this. Because if we explain how much it costs, all the music videos, you know, at the beginning at Canada, they cost nothing. Nothing. It's about friends. It's about like, okay, where we can find a film camera, of course, pay the rolls because shot on film is quite expensive. But it's when El Guincho, when you watch the videos, like, oh, this is Sagrado? Ah, but this is this. It's like everyone from Barcelona, all friends. It's like this. It was shot like this between friends, between people that they believe that we want to do this music video with. Whatever we want. And they did. And that's why Canada is here now. I mean, you know, that now it's a big production company. But it's about people that they believe in the concept, in a style, in the way to do. Not about, okay, this is a huge idea. Of course, now Lope and Nico, they are working with big ideas and big budgets. But at the beginning, it was only concepts.
Yeah.
No.
No, it's true. I think Karen is absolutely true, and you must. It is very easy to have a great expensive idea, you know, but it's very difficult to have a good concept that you can make with a small budget, and And I think that this think small and make it big and then make it bigger is a good way to work, because actually, you know, if you think big, you will have compromises all the way, and it's going to be unbearable, because you are going to be depending on big, like, I need a techno crane, which is like a huge grip, you know, and to do this idea. But okay, you will have your techno crane, but then maybe you don't have a good actor, maybe you don't have a good set, maybe you're shooting in a shitty location. So maybe just leave the techno crane idea and look for a good idea that you can have. Then you can invest the money in having a good actor, a good location, and, you know, the basics. And after that, the more money you have, the more tools, the more toys you can have, you know?
Yeah, we call toys. Like, how many toys you want in this video? It's like, really? I want one drone. I want a secret.
Yes.
It's actually, like this always. But... I mean, when they have a good idea, everything is very, very easy. It just...
And actually, for this music video, I took advantage of the budget because I had never shot a music video with this budget. And I decided to do these car scenes because I wanted to shoot some car scenes. So this kind of naive... from me, but I really wanted to shoot that, so I took advantage of the budget we had in this case, and then I said, okay, I want this toy, and because we had the budget, but first of all, I need the actors, I need to have a good camera set and everything. Okay, so let's go back to the treatment. I was after these couple of references, I was saying that we get into the structure of the music video. So the first part is the car, and then the playback. And I tell that we are going to shoot this playback at sunset in a place with beautiful views. And then the Don't Matter Now part, all these images we are going to display along the song. So you see this like a mood board full of images, of ideas that we don't necessarily need to shoot them all, but we can have some ideas from here and maybe we can add some ideas later. And then in addition, I wanted to add three more parts called ABC, which are people sleeping and the idea of dreaming in something, you know. In one way, it's the idea of dreaming and in the other way, like in dreaming, sorry, the idea of dreaming as a way of escaping, but at the same time dreaming, sleeping in the way of being relaxed. This Don't Matter Now concept. Then people jumping, and I liked this Philip Halsman work of these famous people jumping, and I wanted to do something like that. And for the last part, the dance part, so people dancing and like having fun in a very naive way. And just to finish, as a way of finishing, I like to the idea of this Back to the Future car scene where the car disappears when it goes to the future or to the past, and it leaves the track of the car with fire. And something fun, another anecdote from the shoot is that George has never watched Back to the Future. So
I can't believe it. How we got this treatment. I mean,
yeah, me neither. I don't know. And that's all. So as you can see, there are 13 pages, but one of them is a cover. The other one is the thanks. So it's only 11 pages, and there's almost no text. Most of them are just images and mood boards.
Yeah, true. So if you ever just try to write a treatment, you don't need a lot of pages. You don't need, it's just, you know, a concept, reference, just to have what kind of vibe you want to show the artist, and they can get it very, very easy. I mean, maybe with 5 or 6 pages, we have a good treatment.
I know.
But it's true with 10, between 10 and 15, I think that it's quite, yeah.
But I know directors that they only write one page.
Yeah.
Actually, in the old days, you can Google it and you can find some Spike Jonze treatments. And it's a DIN A4 page. Typed with this typing machine, old typing machine or whatever, and it's just hi, this is Spike Jonze. This is my idea, and he writes the idea, and that's all.
He's a genius.
But but that's old times. Now that's MTV times. Now the artists and the labels are every day more and more demanding. And they expect more from your treatments. And we have sometimes been discussing the treatment page by page with some artists. So it's very important. Actually, the treatment is like a contract. Once, and actually, you get to sign a contract. And yeah. In that contract, you have to deliver a music video that is like your treatment. You cannot say, I'm going to do this, and then you sign the contract, and then you say, oh, no, I don't have money to do this. No. If it's in your treatment and it's in your budget, you have to do it.
Yeah, that's why it's very important, you know, as a music video producer, you have to check very well all the process when the director is writing a treatment. I don't like to talk about about the creative stuff, sometimes it's true that I like to say, like, what do you think about the reference, or are you sure about this? Because of course, you know well, also the brief, maybe the video commissioner, the artist, the track, and maybe you can say, I don't know if is this really what they are looking for. But my job is to say, you can write this because you don't have the money to do this. Of course, you know, you have to check everything. And I think maybe the smarter way just to write this is when you have a loose ideas. Like when you write like, okay, we are in the bar and it's plenty of people, it's like, no, we are in the bar. Let's see if later we can put people or not. Just we're in the bar. And like this always. So just to read again, like, okay, this word, no, maybe this, you know. Because it's true, it's like a contract. You can send a treatment to a label, and after all, after the day, you are falling in love with this idea, say, we don't have money enough, like, come on, you have the budget from the beginning, so.
Also, regarding to the creative process of writing a treatment, maybe you're interested in knowing how I write treatments. And obviously, every director has a different style, and some directors, they are very visual, and they just want to do like very power. They want to shoot very powerful images. But for me, the concept is very important. Even if it's a song as naive as Don't Matter Now, that is only talking about running away and leave everything behind and don't caring about anything. Even that, for me, it's important to portray in a visual and narrative way that concept. So my recommendation is would be to try. I think having a strong concept will help you to win pitches. We call them pitches. Will help you to win the music video. But I know other directors that they win music videos, and they are only they have only a visual interest and nothing else. But I think most of the directors they have that win the treatments the music videos are they have a strong concept, right?
Yeah, I'm thinking. I don't know, in the last music videos, yeah. I think everyone is looking for the same. When you can define the idea, you know, the top line, when you have, you know, one sentence that you can define, okay, this video, what is about this? And the video commissioner knows very well this, very, very well. I mean, you have to understand that the video commissioner is this job. It's reading treatments all the time, but all the time. I'm doing the same, but it's just with my directors. I have 14 directors, and I'm reading their treatments every year. We lost a lot, but we win a lot. But I'm reading everything. But they are reading all the treatments from all the production companies. It's amazing. So they know very well when they are in front of a good concept or not. So they know. So don't try to be cool, like with a Tumblr image and everything. Just think something. And then with this idea, just find the good image. Just to show them, like, I don't know exactly how, I want to shot this because now I don't know, but I know the style is this style. This is the idea, but I think it's something like this. This is the cinematography, this is the vibes, maybe the art direction, maybe, you know, the characters. Because maybe, you know, like, okay, I have this idea, but I know this kind of the character is going to work well. And maybe you can put that, you know, some image from people from, I don't know, series from Netflix. But you can understand, like, okay, it's going to be like this. I don't know. I think they know it well.
So now, we've been 1 hour talking. We have more material prepared to show you. in case you're interested, but maybe we could.
I know what you want. I think. See. Yeah, like try. I mean, maybe we can continue, but with you, like we have a lot of videos to show you, and of course more material. But maybe we can try to work together now in this, you know, the 40 minutes left, if you want. I don't know.
I mean, we are very interested in knowing what you want to know from us. So
yeah, because maybe we're talking about something that you don't want to know. So it's more like, okay, you are a musician, you're an artist, you want to become a director, you are, I don't know, editors. I don't know who you are. Yeah. Just maybe.
I would like to know how it's possible to for a director to work with you. What is the process?
To be a director? Like arrive in Canada?
Yes.
Like, okay, I'm a director and I want to work with you guys.
Yes.
It's not very easy. I mean, as I said before, I get a lot of emails about, you know, musicians, but of course we get all the team a lot of emails from directors, like, hey guys, this is my name, this is my reel, what do you think? You have to do it always, because maybe you are very good, and maybe not this month, but maybe in June someone is going to call you. Because it works like this. Because maybe Canada is like, okay, we have 14 directors, but in 5 months more, they realize that they have, you know, a lot of work. So they need more directors. And in you, they can see something that suits well with Canada and is going to work well in the future. So you just send an email. It's about
okay.
This.
Thank you.
From my director perspective, I would say that first of all, it's very important to direct personal projects, to find your own music videos or to write a short film and direct short films, because there's a difference between a production job and a director job, because in the production job, you can start from the bottom as a runner, and you are driving the clients to the set, and you are doing these small, like these small jobs that they ask you to go and buy some batteries, or go and give an aspirin to the director because he has a headache, you know, and you start from the bottom and then you learn and you can raise positions. But as a director, it's nothing like that. You cannot start as a director assistant director, because that's a completely different job. And it should be called differently, maybe shooting coordinator, because you know, the AD is not the previous job to the director. So as a director, the only way that someone hires you is to have a reel. And in order to have a reel, you must direct personal projects, because in the beginning, no one is going to believe in you. Only you are going to believe in yourself. And that's how I got in Canada. I started directing my own short films. And at that, it was 6 years ago. 6 years ago, Canada was starting to be famous, but it wasn't as famous as it is today. And by then, they were very interested in hiring young directors. And I was the only one in that area that had a narrative style. The rest of young directors were very visual, but didn't have this interest for narrating stories. And I believe that's what catched their attention. So my advice for you would be to shoot as much as possible. Even if it's, you know, I mean, one of the short films that got me into Canada cost me 30 euros. 30 euros. And so you can do it. That's all. Okay, more questions, come on.
When you are getting started with a treatment, how do you deal with writer's block? I mean, do images just pop into your head, or there is some sort of creative process that helps you with that?
You know what? It's a torture. I have such a bad time when trying to get an idea for a music video, because my process is I listen to the song like 100 times and I read the lyrics and I try to find something in the lyrics that summarizes that the concept of the song, you know, like in one line or one word, or it's like you need like a pillar, you know, to hang on. So I always try to find this concept in the song, and then once I find the concept, I try to find to write different ideas that could match that concept. And I also I have a Pinterest account with hundreds of folders, and I go through all these folders and I try to get inspired by all these images, but it doesn't bring me to anywhere. So close it, and I get angry, and then I try to write something, and then I find inspiration in I don't know, watching a movie or just when I'm more relaxed, you know. But I think the most important part for me is when it's trying to find that concept in the lyrics or in the song. And also, I think, you know, as a creator or artist or whatever, you're always thinking in ideas, like in a subconscious way too. And when watching movies or music videos, you see some things that you may think, oh, that this would be a great idea for a music video. And I think these ideas pop up when you are writing a music video. So it's kind of magical, because you feel very frustrated trying to find the idea in a very intentes trobar la idea, o sigui, intentes ser molt metòdic. Metòdic, com es diu metòdic? Well, anyway, so it's very frustrating because you try to find the idea, but you can't. And then you suddenly, you know, remember that idea that you had 1 year ago, and everything, you know, just suddenly works. I don't know. Anyways, did I answer your question? I'm sorry. I'm not a very methodical person, you know. I'm kind of a chaotic person, and it's very difficult for me to tell you how I get these ideas.
If I can say something, think you only have to read, watch things. Just please do something. Because when you're working in something creative, or just reading, you know, a good book, or you are just in an exhibition, or you are watching a movie or something, you can get more ideas. It's like this, it's how your mind can connect ideas and create new ones. So It's about if you ask this to, I don't know, a writer and a general artist. I think it's if you want to be a director, just please do something. It's not going to happen at home alone, just, you know, watching the TV. It's not work like this. I think it's just try to write, to draw, to watch this, and what do you think, and watch a lot of music videos, watch a lot of movies, and let's see, maybe you're a good director. Or maybe not, I don't know. But let's try, just get ideas.
Yes, and I think that's the best advice, because we find a lot of directors who systematically copy other directors and other music videos. And Canada, for instance, has been one of, especially Canada directors, the duo directors, have been copied like 1,000 times, and it's absolutely ridiculous, you know, how people copy in that way, you know. It's like go and have your own personality, please, come on. And I think your own personality, you will find your own personality visiting, as you said, museums, exhibitions, different art sources, not only music videos, but films, theater. You can find inspiration in lots of places, and I think that's a very good advice. More questions, come on. Don't be shy.
Hello, my name is Riccardo. And I see on the screen in your presentation the dot named storyboard. I want to know something about that, because I can't imagine a storyboard of a music video.
Okay. yes, this. Yes, the storyboard. Okay, so
maybe we have to watch before.
Yes, these archives are from my first music video that I directed in Canada. It was a very, very, very cheap music video, like the cheapest music video you can find, and it was a narrative music video, and that's the reason we had we made a storyboard. But I put this here in case you're interested in seeing how you can work with a very small budget. So if you're interested, we can get into this now. Yes? Okay. So first of all, let's watch the music video, and then we will see the storyboard and the rest of the material.
Can I say something? Yeah, and also an important thing. If you also think that you can be a good director with an amazing band, come on. I mean, of course, you have to start with the band, maybe, that they are your neighbors. And also, this is a good advice, because I think this music video is a good case to show this. La Yaya is a good band from Catalonia. It's an amazing band, but come on, nobody knows them. I mean, I love them, but, you know, it's a Catalan band that they also sing in Catalan. But it's a good song, it's a good track, and works. So if you want to try, don't wait at home like, yeah, I want to be director. Like, okay, bring your friends, I don't know, someone that want, they have more or less a good track, more or less, and try to do something. And maybe you're doing a good music video, that maybe in the future this music video is going, you know, it's going to give you a chance to arrive in a production company. It's true that this video, it was just your music video in Canada, but it's no money, a Catalan band, but, you know, it's amazing, this music video, and everyone knows this music video. When maybe you're in London just talking about the Mars reels with a video commissioner, everyone knows this video. It's like, yeah, like, yeah, yeah. And the people say with this weird accent, it's like, come on. They're saying, like, yeah, yeah. You know, it's like, how is possible? Because it's not about the band. It's just, because it's a good video, it's a good idea. So remember this also. It's not, yeah, Canada, they're doing, you know, Phoenix, Tame Impala. Yeah, but also at the beginning, they work with a Spanish band. So let's do the same. Just if you don't have this contact, just try.
Let me now that you're saying this, let me say two quick things. One of them, first of all, is that one of the reasons Canada was the Canada duo directors were so successful was that they are not young guys. I mean, when they got famous with 40 years old, when they were 40 years old, 40 years old and an amazing reel behind them, you know, they had shot tens, like 30 Spanish music videos, 100 commercials, I don't know. So they had a solid, strong career, you know, by then. And that's the reason it was not only because of the El Guincho music video, it was because all the work they had already done before that. And the other thing I wanted to say regarding the low-budget music videos is that 2 years ago, we met these Spanish directors in the UK Music Video Awards. We went to the UK Music Video Awards, which are one of the most important music video awards in Europe. And there was this Spanish director from Madrid, which they made this music video for only, I don't know, 1,000 or 2,000 euros, and they were there nominated for best music, low cost, low budget, but they were invited to a festival, to these awards that. I have to say it's very difficult to get into the British music video community. But let's watch this La Yaya music video, and then we will get into the storyboard and the rest of the material.
No.
Thank you. I always get very moved when I watch this music video. For me, it's my favorite work, and it was a very beautiful shooting. You know, if you want to play the seven different find the seven different game, you know. Between La Yaya and George Ezra. You can find the difference of money, you know. George Ezra is like a major artist with a big budget, and La Yaya is a very small local artist with the tiniest budget ever. And George, you know, they have all this structure, infrastructure with a video commissioner and manager and artist and label and blah, blah, blah. And La Yaya were just La Yaya, were the band. And I mean, we had so much freedom. All the money that we lack was the freedom that we had. And for instance, you just heard the song, and the song was in a second term. It's not even, you can even listen to it well sometimes. It's just there, you know, in the background. And a major artist, a big pop artist would never let me do this. And so we cut the song, we changed the equalization of the song, we did all kind of the characters talk over the song, and I could do whatever I wanted, and they just they were happy to help me, and they were so happy that the house that we used is the singers the friend of the singers We didn't have money for travelings and for the toys that we call them. So the traveling, you know, the father of the singer is an amateur filmmaker, and he built a traveling with PVC tubes, pipes with PVC pipes. So in the traveling, all the travelings had this weird movement like. Clack clack, clack clack, and then in post we had to solve that problem. But it was a beautiful shoot, and 24-hour shoot, super illegal. but everyone did it for free. So it was between friends, and I'm very proud that most of the team, most of the crew today, they are big names in the industry. And the actress too, and the DP, actually Dani Fernández Abello, he's almost impossible to work with him because he's the director of photography of Beck.
No. So you can understand.
Yeah, and that's the reason people do music videos for free, or they lower their fees to do a music video. And it's because they believe in the project, and they believe that if everything goes well, they will have a beautiful piece in the reel, and that will make them grow. And I think this way of thinking should be the same in all levels. This was our first music video, or one of the first music videos of most of the crew. So all of them did it for free, and it was a very small music video. Now we are like in mid-level, so we need to do the same, but with bigger artists and bigger budgets. And then when you are big, you still need to keep doing it to reach the top of the top of the top, okay? And so you start doing your small short films with 30 euros, and then you do a music video for Laia for, I don't know, I don't remember the budget, but let's say 2,000 euros. And then you go to 10,000, and you keep racing, and, you know? But it's a long journey. Anyways, let's get into the storyboard. This is a DIY storyboard. I know. So as you can see, when you don't have money to pay a storyboard artist, you have to draw yourself. I have always wanted to draw well, but I think it's not possible. But you can use from, I mean, I used images. This is an image I found on internet. This is a drawing. This is a screenshot from a movie that I like. I like this is a creative part, but I like the shotgun. Because of the song title is called Los, which in Catalan means the bear, and for me it was like a hand, you know. On one hand it's about like a love story, and it's about growing, you know, growing up, and these are kids who are going to be adults, and they are in between, and they are experimenting love for the first time. And I liked, and the music video is about the girl trying to seduce the boy. So for me, it was like a hand, you know? So that's the how I connected the bear concept to the story. We also went to the location. We scout. We call it scouting, and we also do what we call tech recce. Tech recce is when you go to the location and you take pictures of every shot you are going to shoot. So as you can see, this was the singer of the song, the singer of the band, and this was the producer of the music video. This was before Karen got in Canada. These are early days, early times. And I used them as body doubles for the shot. So you can see, if I show you the music, the George Ezra storyboard, it has nothing to do with this. It's just a lot of random images of mood board pictures, only to remember what kind of shots we're going to do. But it was a different, it's a different way of working. This is a more, it's, this is a narrative music video, so it required a very technical storyboard. DIY storyboard. You can see we use an app that it's a simulator for cameras, for film cameras, and you can see the lens we want to use, a 50 millimeter lens. So I think well, this is pretty much it. There were some shots that I couldn't make because of time. I had this idea that I liked very much, that she smokes the cigarette and she gives it back to the boy, and the boy takes it and he looks at the cigarette, and in the cigarette he sees the lipstick in the. And I thought that was very erotic, like very sexy. But we didn't have time to shoot that. So as you can see, sometimes I also use images, pictures that I find there. But I think this is no longer interesting because it's the same all the time. But we can see this is the floor, the plant. I like, especially when I do so, narrative work, I like to have everything prepared, and I don't like to improvise. I like to have everything super prepared, and I do and redo 100 times the scene until I feel I'm happy with it. And then once I have it all super ready, then I allow some space for improvisation. But first of all, I always like to have everything super ready. So you can see all the camera positions that we are going to shoot. So this also helps the crew to understand what we are doing. I know now you're watching it and you're thinking this is crazy and it's kind of insane, but it's actually easier than it looks. So this is a video rehearsal I can show you too, that we made with the actors.
¿Cómo es?
This is our office.
¿Qué vas a vender?
La agua.
Let me. So as you can see, that's the director of photography, also watching the rehearsal, so he can understand how the film is going to be. But this helped me very to. to know if this is tricky. This is trickier than it may seem because you know the song has this length, and you need to make sure that the actors can do all the actions in an organic pace of time, and at the same time everything is going to fit in that time. So we needed to rehearsal the song until it was perfect. And I think you may find interesting to see an animatic that I made by myself in a DIY way too. So you, in this animatic, I mix the shot that we're going to make and the rehearsal video. This is kind of secret, but that's my reference in that shot. It's from one of my favorite movies, the hairdresser's husband. Well, as you can see, it's the song, but with the shots we took in the tech recce in this when we go to see the location, and the actors performing in the rehearsal, and I don't want to make this too tedious, so I think you got it. Do you have any more questions? Okay, goodbye. I'm leaving. No? Nothing? Are you sure? I knew it.
Hello? I just want to know if you have a group of a part of your organization that is searching for a new talent, like in the recruiting part of to be a director.
So, do you think if maybe you have a team that they are looking for a new talent?
Yeah.
Not exactly. Just, of course, we are working on this. So we usually watch a lot of music videos and stuff. So, of course, maybe you're watching something very, very good. It's like, oh my gosh, he's director. I can't believe it. I love. And maybe you can start to investigate and you realize, that it's a new talent. So it is kind of thing that maybe you share with your executive producer. It's like, oh, I watched this and I love this. And of course, he's doing the same. So in our case, I don't know if other productions company, they have, a properly department. In our case, it's more an organic way. So we don't have nobody in the, like a producer of the new, the researcher of the new talent, we don't have. But of course, we always are there, just.
Okay, so I think that will be all. Thank you so much for coming and for all the questions. And do you want to say something?
No, I know. Just say, yeah, really, thank you. And we would love just to talk with all of you. And I don't know, if someone have any question, and if prefer just to talk with us, you know, now, outside of this place, or taking a beer, it's fine. I mean, I think I would love just to have this opportunity, maybe, you know, 6 or 7 years before. So, because really, it's interesting just to try to talk with someone that maybe he's doing the job that maybe you want to do in the future. So if you want to talk, we can do it. If not, it's fine. And thank you. And thank you so much, Ilaria and Alessandro, again. And I hope that we can come back very, very soon to Torino. We love the city, so. And really, thank you. Thank you so much.